Good morning. Let's try that again. Good morning. You are awake. It is so good to see your faces. It is wonderful to be here in this place. God is present with us, and we are here for worship. If you're a visitor here this morning, we're especially glad that you're here, and we hope that you will sign our registration pads. They're located in the toward the center aisle. Sign those and pass them down the pew. Let us know how we can be in touch with you. We'll hope to do that in the coming week. I'd like to draw your attention to the insert in your bulletin. You'll find lots of information there about what's going on. One thing I want to highlight, for the last couple of Sundays, we've had a Christmas tree in Reed Hall, and folks could pick up a gift list for a foster child. All of those have been taken, which is wonderful. So if you took one of those wish lists, please purchase those gifts and bring them back by December the 6th. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God this morning.
Speak to one another in words of songs. Speak to one another in hymns and songs, giving thanks to our God. Speak to one another in words of songs. Sing praise to God. Sing to God.
Rejoice this day, for the Lord has done great things. Be glad and rejoice in the Lord our God, for God has dealt wondrously with us. Be glad and rejoice in Christ our King.
Rejoice in Christ, who reigns over all creation.
Even in our rejoicing, we are called to name the ways we have turned away from Christ. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Creator God, you placed us on this earth with its minerals and waters, flowers and fruits, living creatures of grace and beauty. You gave us the care of the earth, yet we violate your creation and plunder it. We refuse to share the earth's resources. We seek to own what is not ours, but yours. Forgive us, O Christ, and reconcile us to your creation. Teach us that the earth and all its fullness is yours, and call us yet again to safeguard the gift of life. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. As a forgiven and reconciled people, let us exchange signs of reconciliation and love. The peace of Christ be with you.
Thank you.
One of the great joys of the church is the baptism of children. This morning, Bennett and Leah Atkinson bring their daughter, Iris Austin Atkinson, to God before the community of faith for baptism.
Dear siblings in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. Bennett and Leah, I ask you on behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture Iris in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided and to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? A congregation, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, please say, we do.
We do.
Will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include Iris now before your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround her with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her service to others. We will pray for her that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life.
Let us pray. Eternal God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and this child who receives it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen.
What name has been given this child?
Iris Austin.
Iris Austin, I baptize you in the name of the Creator, and the Redeemer, and the Sustainer. Iris Austin, the Holy Spirit work within you that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Yeah. I introduce to you the world's newest Christian, Iris Austin Atkinson, the fourth generation of Austins nurtured by this church. Her uncle before her, her great uncle William Austin, and her grandfather Austin Robert. And so, I ask you to help raise her in the faith as you raised me, as we have come together and grown in Christ together. I celebrate with you this day.
Will the congregation please stand and face Iris? Now it is our joy to welcome our new sibling in Christ. Members of the household of God, I commend Iris Austin to your love and care. Do all in your protection and your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, Iris Austin, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to participate faithfully in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. That in everything, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray together the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and the word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. A reading from the Old Testament. If you'd like to follow along, please turn to page 741 in your pew Bible. Do not fear, O soil. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things. Do not fear, you animals of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness are green. The tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and vine give their full yield. O children of Zion, be glad and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given the early rain for your vindication. He has poured down for you abundant rain, the early and the later rain as before. The threshing floors shall be full of grain. The vats shall overflow with wine and oil. I will repay you for the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the hopper, the destroyer, and the cutter, my great army which I sent against you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you. And my people shall never again be put to shame. You shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I, the Lord, am your God, and there is no other. And my people shall never again be put to shame. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
like to invite the kids to come forward. And if you want to bring an adult, you're welcome to. Good morning. Did you all have a good Thanksgiving? Did you get to eat some good food?
Turkey,
yeah. What other kinds of good food did you eat on Thanksgiving? Corn pudding. Ooh, that sounds good.
How about you? A little bit of turducken.
A little bit of turducken and a little bit of turkey. That's cool. Turducken. What did you eat? Turkey, yeah. What did you eat? Did you eat turkey too? Yeah. Do you ever think about the fact that all of the food that we eat on Thanksgiving or any other day comes from the earth? The turkeys have to eat seeds and bugs on the ground in order to eat so that we can eat. And all of the corn and the green beans and all of the vegetables and fruit that we eat on Thanksgiving or any other day, that comes from the earth too. God created this whole world, this whole earth, and he called it good. And we get to help God take care of the earth. When I was a kid, I got this book. It's called 50 Simple Things Kids Can Do to Save the Earth. Did you know that kids can help take care of the earth too? What are some things that you can do to take care of the earth? Earth Day, celebrate Earth Day? Yeah. You could, yeah, you can ride your bike more than riding in a car. That's a great idea. Walk more than riding a bike. Well, yeah, walk or ride your bike. That's great. You could remember to turn out lights when you leave a room. If there's nobody in the room, you don't need a light on, right? You could pick up trash at the park when you see it. There's lots of stuff we can do to take care of the earth, and God wants us to help in taking care of the earth. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for this day and for the beauty of your earth. Thank you that we get to help you take care of this beautiful world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, guys. You can go back to your seats. Would you pray with me? Oh God, may the words that I speak and the thoughts that we think be acceptable to you, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. 2 summers ago, my husband Dave and I decided that we would revive the garden in our yard. We made raised beds, and we filled them with good soil and compost. We carefully planted seeds and seedlings, and then we spent a lot of time watering and weeding to keep up with it. And you know what? The abundance and the bounty of God's earth overflowed. It was beautiful. We had a delicious crop of strawberries. We had yummy tomatoes. We had peppers peppers and zucchini coming out of our ears. We didn't know what to do with them all. We had so much basil that we filled our freezer with pesto for the winter. It was amazing. We had so much that we couldn't eat or store that we had to give some away to friends and neighbors. It was wonderful. And I have to admit, we were pretty proud of our mad gardening skills. In fact, I think that we were so proud of those skills that it kind of came as a surprise this summer when the garden didn't do quite as well. And when I say it didn't do quite as well, it was a miserable failure. We got a couple of strawberries. We got a handful of peppers and tomatoes. But by and large, the garden just sat there looking sad and overgrown with weeds. It looked abandoned. And the truth is, it was abandoned in a way. We had just assumed that we could rest on our gardening laurels from the year before. We believed that it would produce the same without the same amount of work. Apparently, it doesn't work that way. A garden requires attention. I think it's often the case that we don't pay enough attention to the natural world. We tend to think of it as a backdrop, something nice to look at in certain seasons or certain light, but on the whole, it's just there. Once in a while, of course, nature makes us sit up and pay attention, like when there's a natural disaster. Or to a much lesser degree, when the deer eat our flowers, or when a family of mice takes up residence in our residence. But generally speaking, I don't think that our Western culture has taught us to pay much attention to the earth, unless it's serving us in some way. Yet Scripture reminds us again and again that the earth itself is a character in God's story of love and redemption. In Genesis, we learn that God created the whole world and called it good. In Psalm 19, we're reminded that the heavens are declaring the glory of God and the firmament proclaims God's handiwork. In Isaiah, we hear the promise that one day the wolf will lie down with the lamb and the leopard will lie down with the kid. In Matthew and Luke, Jesus invites us to consider the birds of the air and the lilies of the field as a way of understanding God's love and care of us. Through Scripture, we learn that the earth is an active participant in God's story. It demonstrates God's power. It illustrates God's grace. And it invites us to encounter God through its beauty. Perhaps we should pay attention. This morning, we hear from the prophet Joel, who offers a word of hope and promise of restoration following terrible destruction in the land of Judah. The people have faced a devastating plague of locusts that wreaked havoc on the earth. Joel has called the people to repentance, and now he goes on to offer a word of hope. What I love about this passage is that Joel first addresses the earth, the soil, and the animals. Do not fear, O soil, but be glad and rejoice. Do not fear, you animals of the field. The earth itself is an integral character in this story of restoration. Joel goes on to remind the people that God will bring them an abundance of food, and God is in their midst. God has not abandoned them in their struggle, but God is with them. Joel reminds us, too, that God isn't some terrible gardener who sets things up and then just abandons the garden. God is in our midst. God pays attention to us, the people God created, but also to the plants and animals and trees and birds and fish and bugs. I don't know if you saw the news about the climate report this weekend. This report that just came out by the federal government paints a pretty dire picture for our country and for the world. More and more natural disasters are happening as a result of climate change, and that climate change is caused by human behavior. Earlier in the week, I read the story of a sperm whale that washed up in Indonesia. Researchers found 13 pounds of garbage in its stomach, including 115 plastic cups. Reading all this news makes me scared and incredibly sad. What have we done to our planet? This precious earth that God created and called good? Why haven't we been paying attention? Perhaps we need to hear the words of the prophet Joel, calling us to repentance. If you're anything like me, it's pretty easy to feel overwhelmed by all of this, to feel discouraged. I'm just one person, and those problems are so big. And I have to admit that my tendency is just to ignore the problems and hope they go away. I'd rather just stick my head in the sand. But you know what? I can't, in good conscience, do that anymore. I've recently learned about John Woolman, who was an 18th century Quaker preacher. When he was a child, Woolman killed a mother robin and her babies just for fun. Afterward, he felt terrible about what he had done, and he began to advocate for the rights of animals. But Woolman also cared about the rights of the poor and those who were enslaved. He saw in the oppression of animals the same systems that were at work to keep people in poverty and slavery. He said, "To labor for a perfect redemption from the spirit of oppression is the greatest business of the whole family of Christ Jesus in this world." In other words, Woolman believed that our primary call as Christians is to work with Christ in the eradication of all forms of oppression. But Woolman didn't just stick his head in the sand when he saw the size of the work ahead of him. When he encountered injustice, he struck up conversations with people about why he believed it was wrong. And he stopped using products that he believed were feeding systems of oppression. John Woolman paid attention, and then he took action. This is part of our call as Christians, to pay attention and then to take action. We make promises in our baptismal vows to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves, and I believe that includes the oppression of the earth. And we don't need to stick our heads in the sand when we think about the size of the problems. In summing up John Woolman's life, author Glenn Hinson says, "Do not let yourself be overwhelmed by considering a problem only in macrocosm. Little efforts matter. Deal with that problem where you are in touch with the problem, and trust God to use your small efforts." So where are we in touch with the problem? When we see trash along the sidewalk, do we stop to pick it up? Can we step up our recycling efforts? Can we compost? Can we cut back on single-use plastics like straws and disposable cups? Maybe we can do less driving and more walking or biking. The kids got it right. Maybe we can encourage our employers to use energy-efficient lights or talk to our elected officials about the importance of protecting our planet from pollution. And if we need more ideas, we have a whole team of resident experts right here at West End in our Creation Care team. Let me know and I can connect you with them. Our call as Christians is to deal with the problem where we're in touch with the problem and trust God to use our small efforts. And remember, we don't come to this work alone. We have not been abandoned, but God is paying attention. God is in our midst. The prophet Joel didn't know anything of Jesus, of course. But as Christians, we understand God in our midst in the person of Jesus Christ. Emmanuel, God with us, God in a body with skin on. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, sometimes described Christ as a physician who has come to heal our wounds and make us more holy. But Wesley didn't believe that Christ's healing power was limited to humans. Instead, Wesley came to believe that our redemption story is wrapped up in the redemption of the whole of creation. God's new creation, the kingdom of God, is not separate from this physical world. It includes the earth and all that is in it, the plants and the soil and the animals and the trees and the birds and the earthworms and the gross bugs. Christ will come again to make all things new, for God so loved the world. Do not fear, O soil. Do not fear, O animals of the field. Joel's words of hope and promise of restoration are good news for us today. Like Joel, we serve a God who is paying attention, who is in our midst. The earth is a character in God's redemption story, and we're invited to play a part too. Next spring, Dave and I will recommit to our garden. We'll try it again. But in the meantime, I'm going to be paying attention to the earth and taking action when I can. May all of us who follow Christ take part in the healing of God's good creation. Amen.
As a people of faith who live under the reign of the God of all creation, it is our privilege each and every week to come together and to speak our affirmation of that faith. So if you would stand as you are able and join me in our affirmation of faith found on page 883 of the United Methodist Hymnal. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. As we come to a time of prayer, we lift up the joys and concerns of our congregation as an offering to our loving God. If you have prayer requests that you would like to share, you may fill out one of the gray cards that's located in the pew racks in front of you. As you fill that out, you can indicate whether you would like your prayer to be shared or whether it should remain confidential. And you can place those cards in the offering plates in a few moments as they make their way down the pews. This morning, our sympathy goes to Rob and John Wiseman and their families who are mourning the death of their grandmother, Nell Frances Wiseman, who died November 16th in Pulaski, Tennessee. Services were held there on Sunday, November 18th. And we also remember Anna Vantrese Wadlington, who passed away on Sunday, November 18th. Services were held at West End on Saturday, November 24th. And finally, we offer sympathy and prayers to Sally Honor as she mourns the death of her beloved and only uncle, Lewis Clifton Hypes, who died on Tuesday, November 20th. Prepare us now, O God, to hear you speak to us as we lift up both our silent and spoken prayers. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, giver of all that is good in all of creation, above all else for which we are grateful this week, it is your glorious presence for which we give the most thanks this morning. Give us hearts that are open to your everlasting love. Grant us the courage to seek your righteousness and justice, and guide us each and every moment of our lives. Jesus Christ, Savior of the world, sovereign over all creation, you are the Holy One whose reign restores every rift and wrong. Come, great physician, free us from our faults and failures. Fill this earth, Heal our hurts and hopelessness, and revive our weary souls and the ground beneath our feet. O Holy Spirit, flame of faith and companion of comfort, empower us to embody your wondrous ways. Shape us, sustain us, and spur us on to embrace your invitation to holy living. Blessed and bounteous three in one God, your very being reveals the truth of your abundance and abiding grace. This day we pray that your children here and around the world would experience this divine reality as your kingdom comes on earth as it is in heaven. So it is that we pray for those around the world whose lives are caught up in the terrors of poverty, of war, of famine and natural disaster. We pray for those weighed down by sickness of body, mind, and spirit. We pray for ourselves that we might always know we are never far from you. Make us instruments of your peace and beacons of your steadfast love. We pray all these things and for those people and places on our hearts and minds this morning as we enter a time of silent prayer. Lord, hear these our petitions as we join our voices together to pray as you taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because God has given us a great banquet, let your thanksgiving overflow with joyous giving for the sake of others and for the world.
Friends, may we go forth this week to pay attention to this wonderful, beautiful earth that God created, and may we work with Christ, our physician, for the healing of the world. Go in peace. Amen.